whole computer science basically not, I personally believe, is most important in Automata, because only because of Automata you come to know there are some machine concept, that is the hardware, and the machine can generate strings, machine can accept strings, and from Automata only you come to know there is hardly a matter of a high powerful machine, how much CPU you have, how much code CPU, how much RAM. It doesn't matter at all. If you have a simple machine, you can do a lot of program. I believe Automata, at least me, is a eye-opener course. And from Automata, you comes to know what is Turing machine. Basically our laptop is nothing but a Turing machine. Where your CPU and is a basically a finite state machine with lots of registers and this. And this infinite tape is simulated by your 8 GB or 16 GB RAM. That is Automata. And from Automata, you know what is P problem, what is NP problem, what is NP complete problem, what is exponential problem, what is Turing halting problem. Until and unless you learn the Automata, you cannot distinguish the complexities of your data structure and algorithm class. Only Automata course will give you the concept of NP versus NP complete, NP hard, P space. The most difficult problem is the unsolvable problem, undecidable problems is the Turing halting problem. So that's it, because only thing I personally believe, the Automata is the course which divides you. The lots of good students comes to the computer science and electronics. The only differentiating point is the ECE students are not taught Automata. And because of this, their knowledge, until and unless students learn by himself or herself Automata, this is the discerning point between the computer science students and electronics and other branches. This is one of the fundamental pillars of computer science. Definitely data structure is one, algorithm is another one, but my belief is Automata. This P versus NP, NP complete, NP hard, in various complexity classes, some issues of context-free grammar, push-down Automata, some issues of parsing. People ask the question of LR1 parsing, which is most important, that I have told you, that is a bottom-up parsing. All of this, the whole compiler, the complexity classes are linked with the Automata. Automata is everywhere. Whenever our parents are not there, are not, like, I miss my Borat parents, but my every talk and my every belief, or whatever I write, my parents are there in my thoughts and all, but they are not there. So same thing, I'll compare with the Automata course in your interview preparedness. Maybe you will not be asked directly question on Automata, but until and unless your Automata is, I personally believe you cannot be 100% confident answer some data structure and algorithm and all. So Automata, I think the first and foremost topic, you should read Automata at your convenient time, not at a distressing time. You relax and learn the Automata, review your classes. I personally recommend Eric Deman, on MIT professor. He has very good lecture on P versus NP. You can see his Eric Deman. I'll quote him. Please view his lectures on P versus NP, then your complexity should come up. And another Automata video lecture, I recommend Shobhnath Biswas from IIT Kanpur. I have probably told you, and Kamala Krithivasan. I found Shobhnath Biswas, and I have found some few lectures. You can view it at your time, because I am very steadfast on taking Automata subject here. The Automata subject, there's a lot of reason why I take Automata. But frankly speaking, whenever I was taught Automata at Jadavpur University, I have understood very little. I also told you in the class that Automata, whenever teaching, I know I cannot fully convey to you, but now fortunately there are some good books, PDF books are available, good faculty videos are available. Please view at your time, like Eric Deman, I told you, from MIT, he's a famous professor, Shobhnath Biswas from IIT Kanpur. So that's it. Automata is a very, very fundamental subject, and it is the computer science contribution to this, to the world. See, computer science is very young science. It starts Alan Turing paper in 1936, 40s. Mainly the mathematician came, like Alan Turing, von Neumann, or physicist, Dijkstra, all this great came. Then the Dennis Ritchie is the great came. Then it is young. All other science, like mechanical engineering, civil engineering, are old. Only electronics came later. Maybe 60s and 70s. computer science is like this. So very young science, and a lot of contribution the computer science make to the basic science like P versus NP, whether P is polynomial problem and NP doesn't mean non-polynomial. So that's it. So a lot of research topics are there, lots of issues is there. Moreover, in this pandemic time, the computer science subject BTEC people are very, very short of time. And I can guarantee you, see, after 1 year, you please tell me, you will get much more better quality, much more better jobs sitting at home because of this pandemic. Because right now the peak time is computer science people who can alleviate the problem, because the issues are there, travel issues, software development, whole paradigm has shifted. You can work from your home, from anywhere. Lot of different way the software should be built up. So you have many roles. So jobs are galore, and the salary is not a problem at all. That's it. So you don't have to worry what questions will be asked, one question cannot be asked. If you have your automata concept is not okay, you cannot, what is P versus NP, what is P problem, what is NP problem, what is NP hard, what is NP complete, what is P space, what is exponential problem, what is not solvable at all, we all know, but we try to demark it. Basically this year we mark it with a single line here. This is start from the, this is only the P problem. This is a P problem. You all know, like, the simplest of the problem is push pop, push and pop. There is O1, and then comes the log n problem. If a binary search tree, already a binary search tree is there, if you want to take any element out of it, it would be, the complexities will be log n. Remember, in computer science, the log n means log to the base 2. Why? Because, but in physics, you see log to the base e, maybe elementary classes, we see the log to the base 10. But why to the base 2? Because it's a binary. Our computer system is mainly because of binary. So that is the thing, log to the base 2. And if it is unwritten, that is log to the base 2. And that is very advantageous. First of all, it is 0, 1. Then you see the 0, 1 bit. Then you see the true, false. Then you see the if, then else. So everywhere in computer you go, so it is a basically binary. That is the reason binary tree is very famous in computer science. Don't confuse with binary tree and binary search tree. What is the difference between the binary and binary search tree? Binary tree, one great example, binary tree, which is not binary search tree, is a heap tree. In binary tree, binary search tree, the right hand side will be bigger than the root, and the left hand side is less than the root. But what is the problem of the binary search tree? What is the problem of the binary search tree?
It may get right skewed or left skewed, and then
because I can, it's a binary search tree. If I make a balance, how many way I can make balancing tree? One is AVL, so that you can, difference cannot be more than 2. There is various techniques so that the binary search tree can be more balanced. One of the technique is AVL, so that it will automatically, whenever a node is added or deleted, it will be rotated so that the root can be always changed. So that problem is solved. So that is, then it will be, you can get most of the time log n. And another technique is red-black tree. Red-black is always, the root should be black and all the leaf black. And in the path, there will be always either red, then black, black, red, black. So by coloring the nodes by the red and black, we can make your tree balance. It is called red-black tree. Binary search tree cannot handle duplicates. But everywhere we have duplicates, say with binary, and you, whenever you have storing values of, say, your numbers, how can you store duplicates? So that is one of the negative points of the binary search tree. But binary tree is much better. Binary tree can handle duplicates like heap. The heap, you know, the mean heap, minimum goes top, and it will not compare with the left hand side and right hand side. And there is great utility of heap. It's a binary tree, and you can get the maximum of it or minimum of it O1 time. That is great. What is the O1 complexity we have got it? Only push pop. Whenever you want to find a element with index n, we get it from an array with O1. O1 give a lots of simplicity. That is the reason we are using stack, because we are only interested in the top of the stack. And another thing is binary tree, max, min, max, and very much used is sorting. You know, the whole sort, our heap sort, is using heap, is making heap. Heap sort is not stable. And what is stable and what is... First complexity, O1, push pop, and then comes the log n, binary search. If it's a balance, then comes the, say, n. Say, if you want to find the element of a maximum of an array, you can get n. Then comes the n log n, like our mart sort, and most of the cases, quick sort. But the quick sort is most of the times it is faster than mart sort. But this worst case is O n squared. But quick sort has problem, it is not a stable sort. The heap sort is n log n, mart sort is n log n, mart sort is stable, heap sort is not stable. Then comes the insertion sort and selection sort and bubble sort. Insertion sort O n squared, selection sort O n squared, bubble sort O n squared. Tell me which sort algorithm of all these sort algorithm I have discussed.
Bubble sort, selection sort, sir, because it takes O n squared time complexity.
Say if you have a number, say if you have a number, say 9, you want to make a selection sort. So what is the thing, or otherwise say it is a sorted, like it is already sorted. Because if I want to make a selection sort, so I have to go there and find the minimum. I put 1 here, then again I have to go there and find minimum 2 here, and again I go to and find minimum of these 3 here. So it is always a O n square algorithm, even for the best case. So this is the best case given to the sorting algorithm. But if you say the insertion sort or bubble sort, they would not make it O n square. The O n square is the best case in selection sort here. Best case, best state is also. So that is the reason the this is the selection sort is the worst algorithm. But sometimes selection sort is, please always talk. So any confusion, selection sort is one of the words, and then come back to again which is the best sorting algorithm. Best sorting algorithm, if you see the stability of the criteria, the same numbers come again. If you have another 10, say in different color 10, and a different color 10, different color 10, say come here also. So you have a 10 here, so you have a green 10 here, blue 10 here, and red 10. But whenever I will sort, the always the green should come first, then the blue, then the red. That means when the order they come in the input sequence after the sorting, that among the 10, the green should be here, blue should be here, and this input order should be made. That means the sorting is stable. There's a favorite, typical question asked is the stability criteria of a sorting algorithm. Mart sort is stable, insertion sort is stable. Among the comparing the sorting algorithm, even the O n square algorithm, the insertion sort is the best than selection sort. That selection sort is worse because in the base case it is O n square. Insertion sort is also O n square, but the constant is much less. You know there is a, what is the constant? See, we have any complexity, you have a C1 here, and that is the n square. Here and maybe C2 here, maybe n here, and maybe C3. So this C1 value is different from the insertion sort and the selection sort and the other sorting. The C1 is the lowest in the insertion sort. In fact, the insertion sort is used even in the mart sort. When the mart sort, after dividing and dividing, there is a 32 numbers in a batch, then they always go for insertion sort. The mart sort is done till whenever there are 32 in a particular segment, they between these the insertion sort. So the insertion sort is very stable sort, that is the ordering would be mentioned. Contrary heap sort, which is in place sort, you don't need any extra place like a mart sort. Mart sort is, you know, you take the extra space, but heap sort is not stable, so that is not maintained, though it is worst case is n log n. So that is the sorting problem. There will be very comes with n all there are two types of sorting techniques. One is comparison based sorting techniques, another is non-comparison based sorting techniques. Non-comparison based sorting techniques are very useful, and they are generally sometimes very useful, depends on the data, and their complexities are generally O n, like bucket sort, counting sort, radix sort. We don't have to compare the elements with each other, but only restrictions are there that the sort, the data should be in a predefined intervals like a bucket. It cannot be have a continuous real value like 1.2, 1.22, 1.33, but it may be like quiz numbers. All numbers may be 0 to 25. We have some buckets, 25 buckets. How many people have got there? How many people have 25? How many people have 24, 23? These are called bucket sort. You don't need n square comparison algorithm. We need only the comparison is O n. That is called, that is the typical question can ask, what is the sorting technique you will use for this kind of technique like counting sort, radix sort. You know, the radix sort is one of the another O n algorithm. But the most of the comparing algorithm, whenever you compare with one element with another, then the best case is insertion sort, and another is the MARS. Another is also team sort. Team sort, I have, team sort is same as a MARS sort. Here, where the MARS sort is equally and team sort is not equally, comes with a batch, and whatever the batch length can be, and within this, it go for what are the sequence, and again divide and conquer. Again, whenever come the size is, comes around 32, it will insertion sort. So basically, in real life, the sorting is done every time, everywhere. It's like Google, Microsoft, all search engines are doing sorting everywhere because they put the, they are sorting and put the data in the indexed so that whenever you are trying to find it out, it would be quicker in Google, Bing or any search engine. So sorting always goes backwards. So that is the maybe 99% activities of the computers, sorting and keeping the data. So any minute improvement would be a good, lots of performance and enhancement if you're response to a program. And nowhere the very only one sorting technique used. Generally, the sorting techniques are used depends on your, you have a given a 1 terabyte of data, which sorting technique you use. Because any sorting algorithm, you can categorize by two types, whether it's within memory, what is it outside memory. Your insertion selection sort, paper bubble sort, heap sort, it is within the memory. And what is your memory limitation? Maybe my laptop, this is my desktop, I am doing it. It is a 32 GB RAM. That is also sometimes, you can take data only maximum 16 GB, not 16 GB because OS is there. So that is not there. That is only choice is MARS sort. Only MARS sort can sort the data whenever in terabyte level. That is also a divide and conquer policy. You make a chunk of terabyte data in a manageable, in divide by conquer, divide and half, divide by two, divide by two. So that is the log n terms will come in any MARS sort calculation. Then whenever it is a manageable size, I have told you again the general magic figure is 32, it will go to the insertion sort. Because there are sorting techniques can be categorized in several ways. One technique is whether it's in memory sorting, in place in situ sorting. In place in situ sorting is insertion sort, bubble sort, insertion bubble sort, selection sort, heap sort, because you don't need any extra space for sorting. Within the same array, you just putting here and here, you can sort. But whenever you need a huge data, say terabyte, petabyte data, you need to sort, and then you have to take the data, make it divide and conquer chunks, then put the data in your memory and do subsequent sorting, maybe generally insertion sort. So it's always a various strategies of sorting techniques. Before I forgot to tell you, selection sort is preferred when generally a sorting, this is a key field. Say if whenever you go for a, this is a key field, and there's a huge data is there, loaded there, huge data. Every, this is a tag, huge data is loaded. The selection sort is there useful whenever you, when selection sort is the only sorting algorithm when you're taking the data to its final position. You don't have to keep up between these, because in insertion sort, you have to again, the data will float. But selection sort, you always taking data to its final position. Always takes the data to final position. There's another sorting technique that is great, that is quick sort. Because quick sort, whenever you choose pivot and you take the pivot, you make the pivot, you take all the higher elements to the right hand side, the lower elements to the left hand side, and that position is fine. So So that is a another great sorting algorithm, it is Quicksort, which is invented by C.R. Hoare in 1960s whenever he was in Moscow too. And Quicksort is much quicker than Mars, though it is worst case, and worst case is O(n) squared, but it happens in 0.001%. It is Quicksort how to select your pivot. What is it? Because whenever your rightmost value, you are selecting a pivot, you are taking always unbalanced decision. The pivot means you are taking rightmost. That is a whole. You should not take first element. You should not take last element. You should take any random element as a pivot, and all the elements which are bigger than pivot, put it on the right side. All the elements lesser than the pivot, the less than the left side. That is, and pivot position is the final position. And that is a huge, and it cannot go O(n) squared under any circumstances, point not one probability. So more, but the, what is the negative point of the Quicksort is, though it is one of the best algorithm in the O, it is n log n, and definitely n log n, which is much quicker than Marsort. But what is its negative with the Marsort is, it doesn't have the stability criteria. If you have different color tens are coming there in your sorting algorithm, they can juxtapose, there will be no order. So that is the negative point of the Quicksort. But in the Mars sort, that is maintained. That is the great about the Mars sort. So what is the greatness of Mars sort? It can take huge amount of data, and it maintains the stability criteria of the sorting algorithm. Quicksort is not stable, heap sort is not stable, but all the insertion selections are there stable. That's it. So Quicksort, what is the pivot element? That is the crucial answer. The answer should be, it should be random. And there is another version there. You can take the first, you can take the last, and you can take the middle. Take the median of it. But that is also not that good, because whenever you are comparing, you are taking first, and whenever you take the last, and whenever you take the middle, it will take the computational power of your algorithm. So it is better to take a random. And random, you take it and make it as a pivot, and the pivot is the final. So what is the similarity between the Quicksort and selection sort? The whenever you are making a pivot, that is its final position. So if the data comes with a huge amount of other data, so in memory, whenever you are taking insert memory shifting, so then the selection sort is one of the good algorithm. Quicksort is also very good algorithm, but the stability criteria would not be there. So which sorting algorithm you should use for what? This is the P problem. So we come, what are the problem? N squared. That what is the N cube problem? Like matrix multiplication. That is the N cube problem. And there's the N to the power 4 problem, N to the power 5 problem. So it is a theoretical possible that a problem comes with N to the power 100. Okay. And another problem comes 2 to the power log N problems. Yes. Okay. That is called non-deterministic polynomial problem. Yes. The first problem is, any problem is n is whenever at the base, like n cube, n to the power 4, this we call the easy problem. And what is another name of easy problem? We call this a tractable problem. So which can you track? And another problem we can see it here, I think you can see it is a Tower of Hanoi problem. So if you have a 8 disk, and if you want to shift the disk from another, and it will take 2 to the power number of disks minus 1 steps. So your data points is 8, and it will be 2 to the power 8 minus 1, shifting will be required. If you have a 3 disk, 2 to the power 3, that means 8 minus 1, 7, we have to make transfer. This is a Tower of Hanoi problem. And there's a typical NP problem, or it is the exponential problem. Because it, whenever number of, it looks simple, but whenever the data size is more, it will be huge. So if you have a 64 disk there, as in, you know, it takes millions of years. Okay, but it looks easy. Whenever you have a 64 ticks here, you want to shift from one stand to another. These are called intractable problems. There is one is tractable problems, that is a P problems. Another is non-intractable problems. But intractable problems, there are another interesting class of problems called NP-complete problems. NP-complete problems, one of the examples I have to do, that is a factoring problem. Say 13 into 7 is 91. If I tell you what is the components of 91, you take little amount of time. If you say 13 into 7, this is called factoring problem. Whenever you have two big prime numbers, maybe 300 digits of prime numbers and 300 digits of, multiply this number, any guess how much time it will be taken? It will take 1 second maximum. But if you take the product of the number to the Python, say 310 digits, and then the Python program will hang. Yeah, it will hang. So factoring problem, whenever you want to factor a big number, maybe looks like a prime number, it will take a very, very infinite it's a big, maybe 100 years for a sophisticated computer. So that is hallmark of a NP-complete problem. What is NP-complete problem? It is hardest problem, one of the hardest of the problem. But whenever you are given the solution, so this is our certificate of solution, you can easily check it. Oh, it is okay, great. Like one more good example is a click. Say we are, you are in a class, both section A and section B. Maybe some of you have a Facebook friends with each other. Maybe one day you decide that today evening, maybe we will meet in a Google Meet, who are friends with each other. Everybody linked with each other. Say we have a 70 students per class, maybe 140 students. 140 students, you go to a Facebook, who is friend to each other. You want to find a maximum group that who are all connected with each other. Everybody, and then you will see it is a NP-complete problem. It will take, it generally is 100 nodes to find a maximum click size. It will take 10 computer years. It looks simple because you have to show each node and see who are friends with each other, which is the maximum graph size. That is a click problem. So again, this all this problem, factoring problems, click problems, in most independent node. Say if it in a graph, not all are connected, and you want to select the points so that there are no common edges among the node, you will see that is the same problem, nothing but a click problem. So these are the problems. There are 3,000, more than 3,000 problems are there. These problems are very, very difficult to find. But whenever it is found, if you give any solution, you can easily check the polynomial time. What I am saying, the problems are very, very difficult to find But whenever you are given the solution, we can easily check it by the polynomial time. These are the characteristics of NP-complete problem. But think of this problem, like a problem of this, it's a chess. So chase, if this is a problem, say Gary Kasparov or Vishwanathan Anand playing a chess, maybe after 16 move, any other, say Koshnoi or any other great, suggest Vishwanathan Anand that you should take the move, you should win. Even the checking that move is an exponential of time. So there are two different classes of problem are there. One is exponential problem. So that exponential problem means that's 2 to the power n problem, 2 to the power log n. So any n data size goes to the in index, that is the exponential problem. But what is the beauty of NP-complete problem is, if you guess it correctly, if the solution is there, then it can be checked quickly. But in check, it cannot be. It is again, you take exponential problem. So this is a more harder class of problem. This comes to this. This is the exponential problem. This is a harder class. So in any problem, whenever you write any algorithm, any questions on algorithm, you always try to figure it out. What is this complexity and how the complexity comes? How can you make it a lower complexity? And this is the NP-complete problem. But any other problem is here between NP-complete and P, yeah, there are lots of problems out there, but generally people, the problems are coming back to here in P problem. In 2004, one professor in Mahendra Agarwal, they proved that primality detection, that whether a number is prime number or not, that is primality detection number, whether it can be some algorithm. And he found it, it is a polynomial problem. Now this is a polynomial problem. This famous professor Mahendra Agarwal right now, is doing all these our COVID prediction algorithm that is the IIT Kanpur algorithm. This is the AKS algorithm. This is called the AKS algorithm, which comes to there. There is always a issue is there whether P is equal to NP. If most of the computer scientists believe P is not equal to NP, if P equal to NP, there will be no such space. So and whole this NP complete problem will march to P, but this is interesting phase. This is the P, whether P is NP or not. There is another interesting phase, NP complete and exponential problem, in which way there is the toughest of the problem is the Turing halting problem. The Turing halting problem, you know, I just did once two type zero grammars. Okay. So what is type three language? Type three is a regular language. Then in comes the type two. Type two, there are two distinct part of type 2 language. One is deterministic context-free grammar, and another is non-deterministic context-free grammar. That is the two type 2 language, and this deterministic context-free grammar is great because that is all our 99% programming language comes from this deterministic context-free grammar. And by clever technique like bottom-up parsing by LR1 technique, we can make this parsing possible in O-N like regular language. What is the theoretical limit of the context-free grammar of parsing? It's O-N cube. So O-N cube, nobody will, if you develop a language, whenever it parsing is O-N cube, nobody will touch that language, because if it's a 10-line program, it is a 100-line program, it will take N cube amount of time. So that's not it. So then we try to make an unambiguous grammar, and it should be run on deterministic PDA, and maybe left recursive may be there, because if it is a left recursive, LL1 cannot be there. So LL1 is a more subset of grammar. Remember, what is one? One means one look ahead. So in both cases, we have already covered the bottom-up parsing is the best. So we try to get parse from the, not from the left hand side, from the right hand side, try to match to the S symbol start. That is the LR1 parsing. But LR1 parsing takes only one look ahead symbol. It cannot take whole deterministic context free grammar. It takes good amount of space of LR1, the maximum, better than LL1, ON. But deterministic context free grammar, that is one catch. Any deterministic context free grammar is not, if two deterministic grammar make union, it is not a deterministic context-free grammar. May or may not be. But deterministic context, complement of a deterministic grammar is a deterministic context-free grammar, unlike context-free grammar. So there are several, you just check your rules of this inclusiveness. So context-free grammar, complement of a context-free grammar is not a, may or may not be context-free grammar. But complement of a deterministic context-free grammar is always a deterministic context-free grammar. Context-free grammar, union of context-free grammar is a context-free grammar, but union of two deterministic context-free grammar may or may not be deterministic context-free grammar. So this deterministic context-free grammar, the best example is a to the power n, b to the power n, but in programming framework, it is better to remember the opening parenthesis and beginning parenthesis. That is parenthesis grammar. That is the best way, because without parenthesis, you cannot write any programming languages, like, again, also if then else statements. For that is the reason the it is better than regular grammar, but regular grammar, you cannot have parentheses. If you don't have parentheses, you cannot make a function call. You cannot have if then else. So you cannot write effective program out of it. So deterministic context free is a must. And then come the context sensitive grammar. We generally know by context sensitive grammar, a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n, or ww grammar. That is a context sensitive grammar. And the matching hardware is again a Turing machine, a left hand side bounded, right hand side bounded. We call it a linear bounded automaton. And this is there it is come, the parsing is NP complete. So there the any context sensitive grammar powered is NP complete. That is a tough. So that is the reason we do not use much context sensitive grammar syntax in our programming languages. Then comes you call the type 0 grammar. Context sensitive grammar is type 1. Then comes the type 0. The type 0 are several grammars are there. Type 0 is one is Turing decidable grammar. That is type 0 Turing decidable grammar, and next one is Turing recognizable grammar. Turing decidable grammar is recursive grammar. What is Turing decidable grammar? Turing decidable grammar means if a sentence, you can see the Turing machine, you give the sentence, throw the sentence on a Turing machine, Turing machine will always halt. And if you make a sentence and make a complement, take a complement of the language. What is complement? Your sigma star is the all combinations, and you minus L, then all this is a complement. You take any complement of the string and throw it to the Turing machine will halt. The Turing machine is halt means it is good. That is, you can call it the problem is decidable. What is decidable is the language and its complement, the Turing machine always halt. That is called Turing decidable or recursive language. Okay, that is Turing decidable problems. Try to understand. What is Turing decidable? Turing decidable problems are that way. It is tough problem. Definitely a tough problem. But if you give an infinite time to your computer, it can solve. It surely solve. Turing machine will not loop around. That is, Turing machine doesn't halt it. Turing machine loop around, do not stop. So Turing decidable is the easiest of the type zero language. There are lots of problems out there in this domain, like any big exponential problem. The Tower of Hanau with 64 takes. These are all solvable problems. We have algorithms, everything is solved. It will take years and years, but it is not as tough as Turing halting problem. Then comes the bigger set, that is Turing recognizable problem. What is or recursively enumerable problems? Same name. If you go to the Michael Sipsa's book, they have distinctly said that what is Turing recognizable. What is recognizable? Recognizable means whenever you take a string from the language, Turing machine will halt, but whenever you give a complement of this any language, Turing machine may or may not halt. That is bigger problem. That is a recursively enumerable problem. But what is Turing halting problem? Turing halting problem goes beyond that. Turing halting problem says, it just only says you cannot design a program that it takes any input and will always say it will, and you can say always predict it will halt or not. That is, Turing has proven, because whatever program you can write, you compiled it, it is a crude way to show you. Whatever program you write it in a Python program and you put it in exe or a dot out or something, it is a basically string of 0101, and you put all kinds of input, it will produce either 0 false or 1 true, either true and false. You cannot design a program which can take any input, it can show that this, that is, either is false or not. What one way Turing has shown, and one way maybe try to make understand. So any program you, if you write it in a dot out, it is a big natural number. Yeah, you know, you have a infinite number of natural number, infinite, countably infinite, is a less number of infinite. You can put it any program in, if you write it, compile it, it will come to a string of numbers with zero ones, and it will be in, and your memory, it will be loaded as a fixed program a dot out as 0 1 strings. And if you put any data to it, any combination of 0, 1, it can always produce either 0 and 1. If you say it is producing 0 and 1, you just put a decimal out in front of it, it will take any real number. You know that between 0 and 1, you can have infinities come infinity, that is, uncountably infinite of real numbers. Say, if you have a 0.01, 0.001, 0.00001, 0.0001, so it is, and then you can say 0.02, 0.002, so it is uncountably different. So you cannot map 1:1 between the smaller infinity, like your source program, and your bigger infinity, that is, you cannot make. So that is, you cannot do this. So that is one way of saying that is, you cannot design a program which takes any program and its any input, and it will surely predict the machine will halt or not. So this is, you cannot design an algorithm, you cannot write a step. But it looks simple right now, but at 1936, when Alan Turing has developed, that is a great idea, and he showed it in the strip of papers and a boxes so that he can read, write either left shift or right shift Turing machine. And it can say, if you have any problem, you can solve that basic machine. If you cannot solve that problem with Turing machine, there is no algorithm for it. So that is the test of an algorithm. So whenever after automata class, you can see what is the definition of algorithm. Definition, if you cannot solve it with a Turing machine, that is no algorithm. If there is an algorithm, but you know the algorithm states that the algorithm have some finite number of states, there should not be a loop, and there should be input data, and there is some output data. It should start and stop. Your operating system is not an algorithm. Your operating system is a process. It is running. It is a process. It is not a program. It is a process. But algorithm is not a process. Algorithm is not a program. Algorithm means you divide the problem in finite number of steps, and steps have some definitive size, and it must start, it must stop. That is definition. But after automata class, you can say that if you cannot solve any problem by a Turing machine, that is no algorithm. Coming back to your Turing decidable? No, that is Turing halting problem is the toughest thing. This is the toughest thing. You cannot have algorithm. Another problem is jigsaw puzzle. If you have a jigsaw puzzle, you can match. That is an unsolvable problem. What do we do? We take every jigsaw and try to match it. If the number of jigsaws is, say, 64 or 128 or more, it will take that amount of time. So algorithm means it cannot have a specific solution for a specific number. Algorithm means if you have a million numbers, but you can try and test it for, say, few numbers, then say 10 or 20 and 30, and then the same thing can be done for others. So that is a divide and conquer. So that is one divide and conquer is Marsh sort, and another divide and conquer is dynamic program. Then only exponential problems can be shortened to a polynomial problem, like 0-1 knapsack problem, like Fibonacci calculation. You take a solution and put it to a table. Whenever you work a Fibonacci calculation or factorial calculation, you do not go to the root and try to find it out. Then it will be exponential problem. To reduce the complexity, a lot of things is we have to. These are the range of the exponential complexity, like Fibonacci calculation. But we try to make it a polynomial one by dynamic programming. That is another way of divide and conquer. Okay. So coming back to this Turing halting problem is no algorithm at all. It is the hardest possible problem now. It is the toughest problem till date. No machine can solve it. Okay. So jigsaw is another. PCP problem is another.